All right. Today's lecture, looking at the different European powers that come in and colonize North America, the contributions to the world, what they are building here in the New World, they're taking away in the New World. So why they're spending all this effort to establish these colonies? What's their legacy? Who are these explorers? What are they setting up? And Hernando Cortez, Ponce de Leon, Hernando de Soto, the early Spanish conquistadors, early explorers of what they are they find here in the New World. How the Spanish govern their areas of the New World. It's called the requerimiento. Spanish meaning the requirement. Look at the French, Jacques Cartier, Robert Cavalier, Sieur de La Salle. Sewer being a title of nobility, commonly just called La Salle. Henry Hudson, Sir Walter Raleigh. Look at the English, some of the colonies they established here. Roanoke Island. Mystery behind it all. The Jamestown colony. General Assembly of Virginia established from there. William Bradford, the Plymouth colony. John Winthrop, the Massachusetts Bay colony. Establishment of the Maryland colony, Roger Williams and the Rhode Island colony, and so forth. I said, if no questions, we'll begin. I'm going to page 17 of the book. Kind of see these early Spanish explorations. And he has Balboa's exploration to Central America and the attempts to try to conquer the Incans, which very mixed results. Now they're sailing up and along the coast of North America. Columbus himself had four voyages to the New World. Amerigo Vespucci on his own voyages and others. Well, by the mid-late 1490s, early 1500s, Cuba basically became the center of Spanish operations in the New World. The Spanish realized they had a fortune waiting on them here in the New World, just theirs to take, after war here being taken. Next, Cuba would be held by the Spanish for the next 400 years until the Spanish American War of 1898. The Spanish colony. The Spanish are mostly interested in making a fortune. As the old saying goes, build God and glory. But while they're here in Cuba, salivating the possibilities, the fortunes that awaited them, I kept hearing stories about this one kingdom on the mainland, where people called the Aztecs. People of incredible wealth, but also of incredible power, almost magical powers. Cities made of gold shining in the sun. Such a fortune just set the minds of the conquistadors buzzing with possibilities. And they could take this and seize this. You have to understand most of the conquistadors here is, yes, there was a sense of adventure aspect of it, but they're basically just here for the money. In particular, Hernando Cortez. Understand the Spanish, a little nervous about these things. They have. Still very superstitious themselves, but start hearing about these powerful, almost magical kingdoms. It's giving them some pause. So the Spanish were giving orders to the conquistadors not to go to the mainland. Do not encounter the Aztecs, because they don't know just how powerful the Aztecs really are. They don't want to get into a fight they can't end. But Cortez, so obsessed with his own dreams of glory and wealth, power, no and decides to ignore these warnings and strike out on his own. It's got a team of 600 men. Seating his orders, he and his men set out on ships away from Cuba, landing at Veracruz, 1519, on the coast of Mexico. The quest is to conquer the Aztecs. When they disembarked, he had everything unloaded, all their supplies, food, equipment, weaponry, including horses and everything else, and ordered all the ships to be burned to the sea. Why burn the ships?
Because his men can't run away.
So they can't run away. There'd be no turning back. Our options at that point were go to the Aztecs, see what they're about, or turn around, go back to Cuba in disgrace, face a court-martial, face disgrace. Cortez wanted to put it in the minds of his men, they had only one option, victory. They must complete their task or die trying. So his men will not abandon him, they will not turn around, they will not mutiny. They must follow him. There are 200 miles of treacherous mountain passes to the heart of Mexico, or what is now Mexico. But along the way, they encountered several tribes trying to fight the Aztecs. The Aztec Empire is an empire of millions of people, many subject tribes in central Mexico. A lot of whom we really don't know about even today. After the conquest, some of them were so completely absorbed into the Spanish colonial system that we really don't know a lot about them. You have to remember, while the Aztecs believed the sun god had to fed human hearts and pick their trek across the sky, and not exactly your plot neighborly Presbyterian, but a lot of tribes that didn't believe that. They had their own gods. They had their own traditions. And they certainly did not believe in human sacrifice. The Aztecs knew this, and so they'd make them provide subjects anyway. During battles, the Aztecs would trying to claim their subjects. They get together before a battle, seeing the opposing army stretched out here. They get there and say, yeah, that guy right there. And so they would during the battle, try to separate that one choice from the rest of the group, capture them, take them to Tenochtitlan, wine them, dine them, take them to the top of these great surmountable pyramids, where they cut his heart out. Hundreds, even thousands sometimes, be sacrificed, depending on the occasion. So you understand, the neighboring surrounding tribes really don't like the Aztecs too much. The Spaniards are coming through. They're awed by their advanced weaponry they have, gunpowder, something the tribes of this region never seen before. Next to there's their full body armor. There's still kind of a transition period from medieval warfare to modern warfare, so they still wore steel armor in combat. They're riding on horses. All powerful, majestic creatures. They've never seen a horse before. Horses, remember, they aren't native to the Americas. All about this advanced weaponry, this strong army, and their common goal of defeating the Aztecs, they allied the Cortez. So they're going to put their fate in with him. And so this increasingly powerful army of Spaniards and Indians, they approach the coast here, the lake with Tenochtitlan, and they sit. And the Aztecs, led by the Emperor Montezuma, see the Spaniards, see the tribes rising up against them, and allow them inside. Shot being fired. It's not so much the numbers of the tribe, the local tribes they're worried about. Aztecs had faced uprisings before. But it's something about this strange group of newcomers. You see, here are these in the shining armor, riding these strange creatures, powerful weapons. Something foreign, something completely unknown to their experience or imagination. Maybe not quite imagination. But they get stirred in the back of their minds, an old story, an old legend. According to legend, years before, there had been a great battle over the Aztec Empire. Losing general, marched off into the wilderness, fired an arrow through a tree. It swore on a particular date, giving it a specific date, that he would return and he would conquer the Aztecs once and for all. Oh, arrow through a tree. Christian cross. You see that conquistadors, they have priests with them carrying these huge wooden crosses with them. The date that was given on the Aztec calendar cycle, it fell on 1519. So it all seemed to be lining up. So the Aztecs believed in prophecy. They believed all this was coming true. So maybe they should just give in to their fates. So the Aztecs surrender without a shot being fired. The Spanish immediately force them into slavery, force them to mine gold, silver, whatever precious gems and minerals they can find. Is it more and more, never enough to satisfy the greed of Cortez and his men? They set themselves up like kings. Montezuma becomes a puppet emperor, directing his people. They're growing tired of it. The drudgery of slavery. The Aztecs were conquerors, not to be conquered. His wealth being plundered by these newcomers. Sit around all day, drunk. So in spring 1520, the Aztecs got tired of it, and they rebelled. Rising up, stoning their emperor to death, charging against the conquistadors. Caught completely by surprise, have no idea what happened. Cortez's men have to fight their way out of the city. Take as much gold and plunder as they carry with them. What can be called La Noche Triste. La Noche Triste, which in Spanish translates basically to Night of Tears, or the Sad Night. Fighting the way out of the city, these narrow bridges. Of course, they have all this gold and jewelry on them, shoved into their body armor. So if they get shoved off this little bridge here, gold's very heavy, it weighs them down. They sink like a rock, drowning. Cortez lost about a third of his men, maybe about 200 on this night. Decimated. Reassembles what's left of his army on shore afterward. Sure the Aztecs were no longer pursuing them. So Cortez is just kind of befuddled here, confused, frustrated, frightened. After trying to figure out just what exactly went wrong. The plan had gone perfectly. And now they lost it all. Why? And now what's going to happen? Except they burned the boats. They can't go back to Cuba. And all these tribes that had allied with them, they know what Cortez and the conquistadors are about now. They're going to enslave them all. So now it's up to the tribes. What do they do? They just accept that the Aztecs are going to be there forever, living under their rule. And then this new group is not going to be a whole lot better. No human sacrifice, but not existence much better. So here's your choice. As you remember one of these tribes here, you go with the Aztecs on one hand or Cortez on the other. Who votes for the Aztecs? Who votes for Cortez? Cavalier. Not very strong, but exclaimed. Tribe decided they hated the Aztecs so much. They hated what they'd done to them for generations that they're going to go with this new group. So stay allied with Cortez, regroup. In 1521, they march back into Tenochtitlan, kind of crushing what was left of an Aztec resistance. Well, the Aztecs, though, still very powerful, though, but in between the initial conquest and the second conquest 2 years later, something had happened. Smallpox. An outbreak had erupted among the in the city, causing tremendous casualties. We're not sure exactly how many, but it greatly weakened. Now here in 2015, most people have never even heard of smallpox. It's the last case 45 years ago. Last case in the United States, decades before that. Completely wiped out by vaccines, but it's a disease that once killed millions of people. Highly virulent, very deadly. Aztecs encountering it for the first time, no immunity, no means of treating it, no idea what it even was. So their forces are greatly weakened by this disease. So with that, combined with the Native American allies, Tenochtitlan is taken. Aztec resistance shattered, and the Aztec Empire is declared to be annexed to the Spanish Empire. Hernando Cortez setting himself up in charge. Since they are Roman Catholic and believe that the religious beliefs of the Aztecs were blasphemous, they ordered all the temples destroyed. I still find just the ruins of these temples around at Mexico City today. Except they're buried, destroyed. The Spanish wanting nothing to do with it. And once the Aztecs fall, the other Mesoamerican civilizations, or what's left of them, start falling pretty quickly. In 1522 and 1528, what's left of the Mayan kingdom was destroyed. Not nearly as powerful as they used to be, they fell fairly quickly. And again, because the astronomical records that the Mayans had were being used for their religious purposes of divination. The Spanish ordered all their astronomical records completely destroyed. The most advanced catalogs anywhere in the world destroyed. There's still more telescopes or anything, so that was a lot of scientific data they destroyed. So because they didn't agree with the religion of the Mayans. Here's the ironic thing. Throughout most of the Middle Ages, the Vatican actually employed an astrologer. In 1531, Francisco Pizarro. Invade the Incan Empire, then conquer it, but it would take 22 years. To conquer the Incans. 1,000 miles of territory up in the Andes Mountains. So the Incans always had the high ground, so it's easy to kind of outfox and outwit the Spaniards, but eventually they did fall. Colombia was taken between 1536 and 38. And of course, that sentenced a lot of these tribes still there today, still some Incans in the mountains, Mayans living in southern Mexico. Other explorers came along, notably Ponce de Leon. 1513, he explored the Florida coast. Attempting to find whatever fabled riches were there, including also the Fountain of Youth, an old legend from Europe, believing that perhaps it was here. They couldn't find it, but millions of retirees have been going to Florida ever since then trying to find it.
What was the year again?
1513. So De Leon did come back a few years later, tried to establish a colony in southern Florida, but Native Americans fought back, repelled the colonial attempt, and Spanish weren't, didn't return for several years yet. The first Spanish settlement in the New World in continental United States would be St. Augustine. So, Jacksonville area. That was in 1565. So the oldest European city in the United States. Well, other explorers, for example, you have the expedition of Pánfilo de Narváez. They landed Tampa Bay in the west coast of Florida, marched north across Florida, eventually going into Alabama. I said they left their boats here at Tampa Bay, exploring inland, and realizing they're a long way from their boats and they didn't have anything, so they tried to fashion these rafts to try to get back to their boats, get back to Spanish territory. Deciding that Mexico was a better attempt, so they sailed west, ended up wrecking off the Texas coast. Narváez is killed, and the second command, Cabeza de Vaca, actual name, translated from Spanish means head of cow. I kid you not. Well, survivors of Cabeza de Vaca trekked their way across Texas. Many of them captured by native tribes, eventually making their escape. They reached a Spanish outpost in western Mexico 8 years later. Some years ago. Then you have Fernando de Soto. Well, Fernando de Soto had actually been part of this initial expedition to conquer early efforts to conquer the Incans. But he convinced the Spanish crown to allow him to explore the interior of North America more thoroughly in pursuit of whatever riches may lay there. So De Soto lands on the west coast of Florida in 1539, similar to the Narváez expedition. Hiked up as far as North Carolina. Around there didn't find much. Went through the mountains. Kind of wandered around the region into Georgia, Alabama, Mississippi, and Tennessee. 1541, he crosses into Mississippi and enters Arkansas. Well, along the way, he had not gotten along with all of the tribes very well. They was trying to shake them down, whatever they had, and it was the same thing here in Arkansas. Like I say, When he arrives in Arkansas, so even though he's Roman Catholic, acting the name of a Catholic king, he tries to portray himself as a god to the local tribes, claiming he is the son of the sun. They said the sun god, the sun in the sky. That the region was something of a drought, said if they paid proper homage to him, he would make it rain. So he built an altar with a Christian cross on it, and as fortune had it, actually happened to rain. Well, the tribes here are impressed with them, but they said, well, we have no gold or silver here. You might want to try this tribe down the road here. Well, they didn't get along with very well. Well, Cortez, Minnesota left, and the tribe here didn't have anything, so he pillaged it. Destroyed it, burned it to the ground. Went to the next one, trying to find something. Same result. Something I have to understand about people is you don't know how anybody is until there's money involved. You don't know how they really are. Soto, Cortez, we find out exactly how they are. Maniacs. Do whatever it could to try to make a small fortune. In this case, off basically stealing it from someone else. And they couldn't find it. Because they committed acts so barbaric, his men were ashamed to record it in their own diaries. And this was the, for the next year, this was what would happen. They're going basically all across Arkansas. I was actually sure, maybe in parts of Oklahoma, maybe in Texas, but mostly in Arkansas. Up into the Ozarks, they thought there might be gold because of the mountainous terrain. And as far as Hot Springs, yes, even in those days it was a tourist trap. So impressed by the warm natural waters, they traveled down the Ouachita River, actually into this area, into Union County. So there's a little marker there about Callion. South of Louisiana, came back into Arkansas by 1542. But by this point, he's in desperate shape. DeSoto's expedition's reputation had preceded them. They're not a group that worked and played well with others. Tribes enraged. Fought back, hit and run attacks on him and his army. And slowly the casualties mounted. Again, 200, maybe more men dead. 1542, Cortez was ill with fever. Not exactly who was sick with, we're not exactly sure. So he goes to this one other tribe here in southeastern Arkansas. Again, desperate for supplies and support. Tries the son of the sun trick again. And this chieftain here, he's no fool. He says, okay, you're all powerful here. Dry up the Mississippi River. Well, of course, Cortez can't do it. And two sides fight. Spaniards have to retreat. And Soto dies. His body was buried in a river, so be no chance of the local tribes digging up and desecrating the body. And survivors, what was left of them, tried to fashion whatever rafts they could to sail down the Mississippi, try to get to Spanish territory, whatever and however they could. Only a handful made it back to Cuba alive. So the Spanish would actually end up with a very thin claim on Arkansas because of this in this region. Now, because of the disaster of DeSoto's expedition, the Spanish would send no more expeditions afterward. To be claiming land. Something name only. Now there are other expeditions. Coronado. Francisco Cortez de Coronado. Let's get this. His pursuit of the fabled seven cities of Cibola.
Cibola.
Legendary city somewhere in the mainland. Such wealth that the cities just glittered in the sun. Coronado, fascinated by this, leaves from Mexico, traveling north, going west across west Texas and Oklahoma, as far north as Kansas, pursuit of gold, giving us another look at the interior of North America. But he found none. The cities of Cibola, as he found out, were mud huts on the Great Plains. The reason why they sparkled in the sun was because the mud they used had a lot of quartz crystals in them. It's a neat effect of the sun. No value at all. The cities were worthless, except to the people who lived there. Other cities we found along the way. Santa Fe, New Mexico by 1609. Found initially as missions. It's run by the Catholic Church, by monks who would be attempting to convert the tribes in the area to Christianity, offering whatever services they could of varying degrees. But essentially, this would be how they would end up trying to establish control over these tribes. The mission was founded in Texas by 1690, but abandoned just a few years later. But it all came down to this, the requirement. The call on all tribes Spanish encounter, except the authority of the King of Spain, as granted by the Pope. And see, the Roman Catholic Church at this time, which is really the still to this day is the largest church in the Christian world. They believe that there's basically this great chain of being, this great chain of authority. Everything went from God to the Pope, who was Christ's representative on earth, the vicar of Christ, inheritor of the throne of St. Peter. And that all the authorities of the king came from God. It is basically, it is God's will. If you are a king, it is because God has said so. If you are a subject, it is because God has said so. And it is not for you to question that order. And the Pope, of course, gave his blessing to each faithful Catholic king, that authority. And so that way, the church and state, and there was no separation of church and state, was one and the same, they'd support each other. The state giving military protection to the church as needed, giving tithes and donations to the church, and the church in turn encouraging the people to support the king. Why support the king? Because that's God's will. If you go against God's will, you are a blasphemer and you're damned to hell for all eternity. Resist the king, you're a traitor in this life, and damned in the next. That way they help maintain order. And the Spanish are trying to use this in the New World to maintain control. So whenever the Spanish would come across this new tribe, they would read this new settlement, they'd read the requerimiento in Spanish. The group of people have never heard Spanish in their lives. They accept the Pope's authority and the King's authority. They'd be converted to the Roman Catholic faith. Now, there were those who were legitimately interested in saving souls, and those establishing missions, really trying to help the tribes. But as time went on, though, they were mostly in the minority. There are some missions running away that you would only be given help if you were a devout Roman Catholic, came to work at the mission and live at the mission and abandon the tribes. They said live as a European. There are some monks and missionaries who were killed on their expeditions to these tribes, who did not like these newcomers coming in and talking to them about this. They didn't know who they were, what they're talking about, and just wanted them to leave. And there are those who protested the enslavement of Native Americans. The Pope actually would later send out an order saying it was a sin to enslave these tribes, but by the time these orders went out, most of the Native Americans of this region were dead. So Spain is aggressively converting the tribes to Christianity. Mission set up throughout Spanish dominions in the New World. By the mid-16th century, except for Portuguese Brazil, Spain is almost unchallenged in the New World. It's got an entire hemisphere almost to themselves. The tribes, meanwhile, are decimated by overwork and forced servitude. Many served on large encomiendas, these large estates. A little more than a medieval manor. Spanish officers control these large areas, including villages. Now, while the conquistadors are sworn to protect these missions and villages, those in charge of them, the encomenderos, can levy taxes and labor to support these ends. The 17th century is estimated the Native American population of the New World dropped from about 50 million to about 4 million, a drop of more than 90%. So it rises again about 7.5 million by the end of the 19th century. Again, going about 50 million down to 4 million. By the mid-16th century, the total European population, the Spanish population, is only about 100,000. Compare that to the dwindling millions of Native Americans. So as a result, a labor shortage arose. The Spanish are trying to squeeze every dime out of the New World they can. Gold, silver, jewels, agricultural products, whatever they can. So they need somebody to do all the dirty work for them. The Native Americans are dying left and right. The disease, overwork, some just running off. So there's only one source of readily available cheap labor left. Where's that?
Africa.
So there was a small slave trade between Europe and Africa. Mostly it was selling Europeans into African slavery, but the trade did exist. So as early as 1503, Spain began importing African slaves to the Americas. And as the century wore on, that process accelerated. Eventually, millions of Africans being brought to the New World. Yeah.
In the first thing you said, it was with the slave trade, it was mainly Europeans selling Europeans into slavery into Africa.
Yeah.
What was the benefit of that? Many.
Just basically, they're being kidnapped and being sold into slavery. Basically, just people have to be trading with Africa. They have to find them. Somebody lost, they kidnapped them, just sell them, make a few quick bucks. It wasn't an extensive trade, but except they did it because there was money to be made, not a lot of it, but enough for an individual's satisfaction. You've got to remember, there are some very unsavory characters on the coast here. You have to understand that slavery still exists today in many parts of the world. I think it's sweatshops in Asia and operating legally parts of the Americas. Prostitution, more than half of prostitutes are held as slaves against their will. Again, ask the question, what's the benefit to that? None. Just makes a little bit of money for one sick individual, that's about it.
Yeah,
that's the same thing here.
Sick is indeed the right word to use.
Yes. But most of the slaves are going to be taken from Africa to the New World, mostly be coming from West Africa. Again, see, this was Spanish and then the French and the English coming in. You have all this effort. Why are you establishing colonies? This is an effort to explore and set up these communities. Why are they doing this? Why? What's the point? Why would a nation establish a colony?
To try and conquer.
Conquest, but why else?
I believe it has something to do with what does the land provide. Yeah, not only does it provide space for settlement, but it also provides rich soil to, and also crops, and also different fruits and vegetables, but very supportive to the other nation.
Yeah. So kind of what does the land provide? In some areas, it's more productive than others. I mean, this wasteland, completely worthless for agriculture, but it has something there. Now remember, every colonial enterprise in history, no matter where it is, all comes down to one thing.
Commerce.
Commerce. Money. Cash. Dinero. You establish a colony because you want to make money off it. It's going to be different things in different areas. And so not everything has a gold, silver, like the Spanish possessions in the Central and South America. Not everything has rich farmland, but you're going to find something somewhere. There's a reason why all these countries are spending all this money to set up these communities and building up militaries and not only control these lands, but defend them from someone else who might want them. It all comes down to the profit motive. You want to make money off your colonies. And the Europeans want to be making money hand over fist in their colonies. Then be developing a standard of living never before seen in history because of these colonies. And of course, the secret's getting out. The Spanish are making a lot of money. And so the other nations start sending out their own expeditions and try to figure out this. Well, what are they doing? What's out here? So France comes along. Jacques Cartier comes along, explores the Gulf of St. Lawrence. When he was in Quebec in 1534 and 1535, eventually French colonies established in Quebec along the St. Lawrence River. 1542 and 1543. The initial attempts fail, but they keep trying again. Eventually, by the early 1600s, the whole region of eastern Canada under French control, called New France, you have permanent colonies along the St. Lawrence River. That's Canada, roughly between, takes up a good portion of the border between what is now Canada and the United States. More or less. No gold or silver here, but a lot of other things, a lot of agricultural products. Among other things, the fur trade. It's cold in here, if you need coats. Fur was a very valuable commodity. It's kind of out of fashion, out of style now, because nothing on a lot of little critters being killed, but also. Synthetic fabrics we made now. But France made a lot of money off this. And trading with the Native American tribes, they'll make a tidy little profit here. But understand, though, it's not exactly an egalitarian relationship always. So, for example, they may want to trade a stack of pelts for a rifle. They'll say, okay, you have a 6-foot-long rifle, bayonet attached. It's okay, a number of pelts from the floor up to the top of this rifle, and you can have it. basically flat pelts about the size, about a, not much thicker than this packet here. So a lot of the woodland critters being killed, being given to the French in exchange for just a few dollars worth of goods. French making a lot of money off this, but generally the French are going to try to keep their customers very happy because this trade empire they're building in the Americas in the Great Lakes region, St. Lawrence River Valley, eventually the Mississippi River Valley, that's how they're making their money, trading with the tribes. Like I said, not near the money the Spanish are making and spending, but enough to keep the French coming back. Tidy little profit margin. Along comes this man, Saul. Now, Saul had been kind of a ne'er-do-well. Never could quite figure out what he wanted to do in life. But, so eventually his family sends him over to America, Canada, where his brother, the priest, in Canada, Saul realizes his calling, that he's going to establish a colony here in French... in these French possessions of the French Empire. Basically, he's going to build settlements. So he starts exploring, sails down the Mississippi River from the Great Lakes region south, comes to Arkansas, meets the tribes here. They're friendly enough. It's the Quapaw tribe he met. Quapaw. And so the name Arkansas is actually a French variation on the Quapaw, the major tribe of the region. Well, LaSalle wanted to know if the Mississippi River went all the way down to the Gulf of Mexico. The tribes certainly did, but said the tribes further south, though, were very inhospitable and he shouldn't go further south. So, take them at their word, LaSalle, somebody decides to claim the whole region. So he stands on the banks of the Mississippi in traditional French fashion, shouts as loud as he can to the four directions that he's claiming this land for the King of France. And of course, these tribes can't speak French. And how far does a human voice carry on a good day? Maybe a mile?
A mile or two.
Yeah, depending on the acoustics.
Yeah.
But he claims the entire Mississippi River Valley. This is including all its tributaries, the Ohio, the Red Rivers, Ouachita River, Missouri River, everything else. Claiming that whole thing for France. Yeah. And he names it after the reigning king of France at the time, Louis XIV. Naming it the whole region, Louisiana. Over the decades, French trading posts be established up and down the river. Arkansas Post, the first European settlement in Arkansas, was founded in 1687. Back for many years, I was the only European settlement in Arkansas around the Mississippi River. Well, 1684, LaSalle tries to come back to the region, sailing south through the Gulf of Mexico. Somehow misses the mouth of the Mississippi River. And how he did that, it's a mile wide at that point. And sailed on to Matagorda Bay. Well, here they land, decide to make the best of established Fort St. Louis. Part of fleet left and turned to France, but they didn't know how exactly to survive this land. The supplies went fairly quickly, so it began to die of disease and hunger. The inherent Matagorda Bay region of Texas, the tribes here really didn't like the French very much, so they're facing pitched battles with them here and there. The one ship that was left behind, the captain got drunk and crashed onto a sandbar one day. You cannot make these things up. So by 1687, LaSalle and a few of his men decided they're going to try to reach the Mississippi River, walk on foot, try to tap into the trade of the Illinois country, and try to bring back help. Because basically, they basically forgot about. Well, along the way, some of the men here mutiny and kill LaSalle. He had a couple cousins with him who rose up and killed these men, and they barely managed to make it back to Arkansas Post. A rescue party sent as soon as they could. By the time they got there in 1690, the settlement of Fort St. Louis had been wiped out by the tribes. Actually, it was almost 300 years later that they actually found, the archaeologists actually found where Fort St. Louis actually was. And it's because of this the Spanish start building all these missions in South Texas, trying to lay claim to the loyalty of these tribes as quickly as they could, fearing the Spanish, the French are trying to move in on the territory. By 1693, though, this effort had died back, realizing the French weren't going to make any trust type of a move against their territory. Others came on, the Dutch. Even though the Netherlands is a small country, they came very wealthy, very powerful from trade. The early expeditions through the efforts of this man, Henry Hudson, 1609, sailed up what is now the Hudson River in New York. Dutch colony in the area is found as a new Netherlands. Basically, lower New York and upstate New Jersey. Dutch fur trading posts were established on Manhattan Island by 1614, and at Fort Warren, which is the present-day city of Albany. Again, like the French, mostly trade, fur trade. Trying to tap into the markets that are there. The island of Manhattan was bought from the Manhattan tribe for about $20 worth of glass beads.
Real.
Basically, next to nothing. They're still debating who got the better end of the deal on that. Did I say that? Well, cities later established on Manhattan, New Amsterdam, incorporated in 1626. It's New York City. Basically, it's all that's left of the Dutch settlements. There's a few place names, a few neighborhoods like Bedford Stuyvesant neighborhood. Wall Street was actually founded, actually as a marketing center there on the coast called Wall Street because it had a seawall there. But the Dutch population remains small. Sweden makes an attempt at it. Fort Christina was established as a trading post in Delaware, actually the present-day city of Wilmington, Delaware, since 1638. Well, New Sweden was conquered by the Dutch effortlessly in 1655. In 1664, the next more powerful one, assuming the next weaker one, maybe up the chain, the English fleet arrived off the coast of New Amsterdam, commanded by the Duke of York. Seeing the power of this fleet, and they had no means of defending themselves, New Netherlands surrendered without a shot being fired. So, since the Duke of York is in charge of this expedition, he gets to name it whatever he wants. So New Amsterdam was renamed New York. And of course, our possessions in Delaware were taken as well. Now, Hudson is also known for another one's expeditions, the Hudson Bay region in Canada. Now, there was a reason for this. Now, they're still trying to reach Asia. They've got these big continents in their way. And so there's this theory of something called the Northwest Passage. I mean, these continents can't possibly be so large there can't be a way through. I think they may just have to find a way to sail around America. I mean, there must be some passage in the northwest where they can just sail on through to the Pacific Ocean. Looks like they explored Hudson Bay, thinking this might be part of it. Hudson River area, maybe that might be part of it, but never could find it because it doesn't exist. It's a solid wall of land from the Arctic Ocean down to Argentina. Nevertheless, other expeditions came along. John Cabot of the English flag explored the coast of Newfoundland in 1497. Sir Francis Drake explored the New World while he's commissioned by Queen Elizabeth I to raid Spanish shipping. Francis Drake ended up actually sailing all the way around the world in his efforts to try to raid and avoid Spanish ships. But then Sir Walter Raleigh comes along, his half-brother Sir Humphrey Gilbert. Walter Raleigh is going to try to establish the first English colony in the New World. As Currer Royal Patent in 1578 colonized the New World, it was basically, they're getting permission of the king to in this case, Queen Elizabeth, to settle this land. Why are you going to ask for the Queen's permission? Because you want that protection of the English military. If something goes wrong, the English Army or the English Navy has your back. Okay, you're under English control, but they're loyal Englishmen anyway, so that's not such a big deal. You're in the English trade system, protected by the English military, so you get their permission. English permission to colonize the name of England. Well, England's experiencing growing population and religious strife as the Protestant Reformation swept Europe. A lot of discord between Protestants and Catholics. So a lot of people interested in leaving, finding someplace new to start over. So in 1587, he established a colony in the Outer Banks of Roanoke Island off the North Carolina coast. The Outer Banks is the area that gets hit by the storms the most. Well, Roanoke has established a population of 117 men, women, and children. Not a big colony, but enough to get started. Virginia Dare, the first English child in the New World, was born there. Well, Raleigh sets them up. Raleigh, of course, the name for the capital of North Carolina. He leaves, goes back to England to take care of some business things, get some supplies together, and come back. But he's delayed. He doesn't come back until 1590. By that time, the Roanoke colony had completely vanished. The buildings were there. They're intact. The people are gone. No bodies. No signs of destruction or struggle. No notes. No nothing.
So the disappearance of Roanoke is one of the biggest mysteries in the world.
No one knows what happened. All's left was some cryptic note on the tree, Crotoan. There was a tribe with a similar name nearby, but they didn't know anything would happen to them. All they get was third-hand reports from conflicting reports from local tribes of what had happened. No one knows. Either they went up and left, went to another region, like Chesapeake Bay region, were conquered by a neighboring tribe and carried off, or willingly went with them. No one knows. But in the ensuing centuries, there are a lot of reports of Native Americans, a lot of blonde hair and blue eyes running around. What happened to them? Who knows? Stop off then.